Well, hello everyone. So today we'll be continuing with Pelton Wheel. So Pelton Wheel is a you know turbine found after named after an American scientist L.A. Pelton. Well, it was a renovation or your extension of your water turbine. Your water turbine was a wheel with flat blades, and Pelton was able to modify it so well that he was able to get a very good efficiency from this turbine. Well, during that time, there were a lot of design in this shape. This shape is a factor for which this turbine has become very famous. Earlier, these plates were just flat plates, you know, flat plates. That was a water, normal water turbine. And then, during that time, around 1900s, there were a lot of innovation in this design, and Pelton was able to come up with a very successful design. Now, your Pelton wheel has a few characteristics. First thing, it is an impulse turbine. That is, the energy at inlet is purely kinetic, and there is the pressure is maintained at atmospheric pressure. Okay, it is a tangential flow. This figure is quite clear. It requires a high head, okay? Head, I already told you in the last class, what is the meaning of high head, low head? It requires a high head for better working of the turbine. And though it requires high head, I can compromise on the discharge. It requires low discharge compared to your Francis and Kaplan turbine. And the shaft of this turbine is horizontal. Now your shaft is this portion, which is attached. That it's said to be horizontal if it is on the horizontal plane. Okay, this is my runner and this is the shaft. So if the shaft is said to be horizontal, if it is along the x-axis. Now coming to the different parts of the Pelton wheel turbine, the main parts are you have a nozzle and spear arrangement, runner and bucket arrangement, casing and braking jet. I'll show you a figure which explains everything a little better. Your spear nozzle arrangement. Now from the penstock, penstock connects the upstream of a dam to your turbine. At the entrance, before it enters a turbine, there's a reduction in the area. The reduction in the area is because so that my velocity is high when it reaches a turbine. That opening, the smaller area opening, is called as a nozzle. Now to decrease and increase the speed or the velocity of flow, I have a spear arrangement. So if it goes back, I can increase the velocity. If I push it front, I can decrease the velocity. So this is my spear. It can be operated manually or automatically depending on my design. So this spear arrangement makes sure I can, with that, I can increase or decrease the velocity of flow. Now your bucket, I'll just tell you the next thing. The third thing is your casing. This is my casing. It does not have any functionality. It makes sure that the water does not splatter too much outside, and it is directing all your water to your tail race. So it's just a covering, it's non-functional. And the fourth is your braking jet. Remember that the turbine is moving at a very high speed, you know, very high speed. So even if I completely stop my flow of water, it will be still rotating for some time. To stop it at a little earlier stage, what do I give? I give a small amount of water in the opposite direction, in the opposite direction of flow. So if it is going in this direction, this is your anti-clockwise direction, I am providing water in this so that through clockwise motion, the turbine or the runner is able to stop at an earlier stage. Now coming to the second point, your runner and bucket arrangement. This central portion is your runner. This is your runner. And you can see your buckets are very, you know, uniquely shaped. Okay. Now coming to the next slide. Now this is your bucket. It has got two hemispherical bowl or cup, and it is divided by a splitter, and in this splitter is where your water is attaching, you know, your water is entering, and then it is equally splitting into two halves. So when my jet of water is directed, it hits the splitter and it's able to move smoothly across the other two. Now this bucket design was the reason why your Pelton wheel had become so very popular. And generally, the buckets are shaped in such a way that the jet gets deflected through an angle. Now this angle, the angle of deflection is around 160 to 170 degrees. So this is my jet entering. It leaves like this. Your angle of deflection is from my, you know, inlet, what angle it is getting deflected. So this picture tells you very clearly what is the size of the bucket, and this is a velocity triangle we'll be drawing in your after a few slides we'll be drawing. And this buckets are made up of cast iron, cast steel, bronze or stainless steel, and depends on the head, what is the head available, based on that the material is decided. So remember, it has got two hemispherical bowls or cup, and it is divided by the splitter, and this splitter is a portion where the water is being directed. Now coming to the velocity triangle, as I saw, this figure is quite clear enough. It is coming at inlet, outlet. Now here you can know it is all directed this side. So your beta angle is always acute. When I come to my inlet, your theta and alpha are both zero because it is horizontal. So when I come to my velocity triangle, I can see it is in the same line. So my V1, U1 are in the same line. My alpha and theta are zero. And since all are in the same line, my relative velocity VR1 is V1 minus U1. And I was dividing my, you know, V1 into its horizontal and vertical component. So my V1 is entirely the horizontal component. So I can write V1 is equal to VW1 and VF1 is equal to zero. Now the water is striking here and it's coming to the outlet. Now here again, it is smooth. There is no shock. So VR1 is equal to VR2. So from here, we are coming to VR2. Your VR2 makes an angle of phi, as you had seen earlier, and your V2 makes an angle of beta. In Pelton wheel design, your beta is always less than 90 degrees. Okay, and in your problems, there will be angle of deflection given. Your angle of deflection is your angle made by the relative velocity with respect to your horizontal axis. So this is my angle of deflection. Knowing my angle of deflection, I can calculate the value of phi. You can see, you can calculate the value. That is nothing but 180 minus your angle of deflection. And remaining all are same. Remaining all are same as your normal velocity triangle at outlet. Only at inlet, we can see it is a horizontal line. And here, your wheel runner is huge. Your buckets are small. So I can assume U1 is equal to U2 is equal to U. And without shock, it's very smooth shape of your, the bucket shape is very smooth. So I can assume that VR1 is equal to VR2. Now next we'll be calculating the force, and then after that we'll be calculating the work done, and then the efficiency, as we have done in the previous classes. So I have given you what is, you know, the same thing, velocity triangle. Your V1 is equal to VW1, your velocity of jet at inlet. U1 is the velocity of bucket at inlet. VR1 is the relative velocity. VW1 velocity of whirl, and VF1 is equal to zero. And at outlet, again same thing, all the things I have described it for your reference. And whenever you draw the velocity triangle, if they ask you to draw, please write each element. It is important. Now coming to the force exerted by the jet in the direction of motion. My formula for force I had earlier calculated as rho A V1 into VW1 plus VW2. Your VW1 plus VW2 comes when beta is less than 90 degrees. Now this, if you remember it clearly, here it was VR1, rho A VR1. I am talking about the force exerted on a moving, moving curved plane. Okay, so here I'm considering V1 because the rotation of the bucket is happening purely due to the jet. Okay, it is moving just because of the jet. So since it's moving only because of the jet, instead of your relative velocity, I am taking my V1 value. So my Fx is equal to, along the direction of motion, is rho A V1 into VW1 plus VW2 And why this is plus here? Because beta is less than 90 degree. Now, what we are trying to do here is we are trying to find what is VW1, VW2, etc. Now, here my V1 is given by root 2GH, where capital H is your net head. On the right hand side, I have explained the terms which will be useful or which will be given in the problem. Your HG is your gross head, HF is a head loss due to friction. It is generally given by your Darcy's equation, 4FLV² / 2GD. H is my net head. Now, net head in problems, either they can give it directly or else they can give, you know, gross head and some loss or some, you know, they'll give the value of LD, etc. Or else losses in terms of your gross head. Okay. So either they'll give you directly the head H, capital H, or they will tell you either the value of HG or what are the value of losses, or you have to calculate the losses depending on the problem. And then capital D is your diameter of the wheel or diameter of the runner. N is the speed of the turbine. Okay. And it is an RPM, rotations per minute. Small d is the diameter of jet. And knowing small d, I can calculate small a, that is the area of jet. So here your area is coming into picture. Now here V1 is root 2GH. Your root 2GH comes from, if you remember, your V square is equal to U square plus 2AS. That we are using in the vertical direction. Okay, so there we are getting V1 is equal to root 2GH. Your U, that is your speed of your bucket, U1 is equal to U2, is given by pi d n by 60. Whenever we have a rotational motion, generally your speed n is given. If the speed is given in RPM, you can calculate U based on this formula, pi d n by 60. And remember this formula, it comes in your design, I'll tell you, but remember this formula, pi d n by 60. And it would be better that you all have your notebook when you do this, because these are all formulas which will be helpful in your problem. So I would advise that when you're going through, you have your notebook. Now then we'll draw the velocity triangle. At inlet, it was all a straight line. So it was very clear, VR1 is equal to V1 minus U1. Since U1 is equal to U2 is equal to U, I can take V1 minus U. And what about VW1? Your VW1 is equal to V1. Okay, why? Because your alpha is 0, theta is 0. Now coming to outlet. So outlet, I'll just show you the picture once again. So outlet, my intention is to calculate the value of VW2. Okay, now for VW2, I can easily calculate VR1. V1 minus U1 or V minus U, and I know that VR1 is equal to VR2. So I'll write in terms of VR2. So if I want to know VW2, I can write VR2 cos phi, that is a horizontal component, minus U2, I'll be getting VW2. So I'll make use of that here. So my VR1 is equal to VR2. The buckets are smooth, there is no shock. And then I can write VW2 is equal to VR2 cos phi minus U. Okay. Now I'll be substituting these two in the equations further. And Fx, rho AV1 into VW1 plus VW2. Now next is the work done by the jet on the runner per second. Now, this is the thing they're going to ask in the problem, work done and its associated efficiency and power also sometimes. So work done per second is given by force into U. Your force you've already calculated, rho AV1 into VW1 plus VW2 into U. The unit is Newton meter per Newton. Now, since it's a machine, they'll be definitely asking in your problem, what is the power given to the runner? Now, power is simply dividing by 1000. I'll be getting the power. Your power formula itself is rate of doing work. Okay, that is nothing but work done per second or work done per time. And the unit of power is kilowatt. Again, K is small, W is capital. And the next thing is, as we have mostly done, work done per second per unit weight of fluid striking per second. It's the same thing. We are dividing by the weight. The weight is given by rho AV1 into G. If you simplify it, I'll be getting 1 by G into VW1 plus VW2 into U, Newton meter per second. Next is my efficiency, and here we are calculating only the hydraulic efficiency. Your hydraulic efficiency, if you remember, in terms of power, the input is water power, your output is runner power. Now here we'll be calculating in terms of energy and kinetic energy per second. The output is work done per second. Now here, what is the kinetic energy? Your kinetic energy is half rho A V1 into V1 square. And the efficiency, if you want, we have already calculated the work done per second. So your hydraulic efficiency is rho A V1 into VW1 plus VW2 into U divided by the kinetic energy per second. So I can simplify it. I can cut these both. I can cut this and this. My 2 will go upstairs. So I'll get 2 into VW1 plus VW2 into U divided by V1 square. Now here, this I want to simplify. If you have seen from the inlet and outlet triangle, your VW1 and VW2 are all in terms of V1 and U. So I'm trying to simplify it further. Okay, if I simplify it, I again start with this. I know I got that from my velocity triangles at inlet. I know VW1 is equal to V1. Now next, I'll try to calculate VW2. So VW2 I had written, it is equal to VR2 cos phi minus U. Now what was VR2? Your VR2 was equal to VR1, and that was equal to V1 minus U. So I'll substitute that in W2, VW2. So VW2 I'll be getting V1 minus U1. So I've substituted this value into cos phi minus 0. So if I simplify it further, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to simplify this term, VW1 plus VW2. So I've got V1, VW1 and VW2. So I'll add these both. So when I add these both, I have got V1, VW1 is equal to V1 plus this term, that is V1 minus U into cos phi minus U. I'll take this minus U to the side. So I've got V1 minus U plus V1 minus U into cos phi. So I can take V1 minus U common. So if I can take it common, I'll be getting V1 minus U into 1 plus cos phi. And this I will be substituting in my equation of hydraulic efficiency. This I can even substitute this in my formula, in my work done formula also. So it depends on what we asked, how it is asked. I can even substitute it here. So here when I substitute it, I'll be getting 2 into V1 minus U into 1 plus cos phi into U divided by V1 square. Now we have got the hydraulic efficiency of the jet. Now I want to know further what will be the maximum hydraulic efficiency, and the condition is for a given value of V1. When I say given value of V1, I'm saying for a given velocity of jet, what can be the maximum possible efficiency? Okay, so my V1 is constant for a particular velocity. What can be the maximum efficiency? So in this case, what I'm doing, V1 is constant. Since my shape of the bucket is, you know, almost decided, my phi also is a constant. Remember that phi, this is phi. This is my phi value. So what is happening based on the shape of the bucket? This is my angle of deflection. The angle of deflection is generally 160 to 170 degrees. So it's almost constant. We can fix the value. So here when I'm finding my maximum hydraulic efficiency, my V1 is constant and my phi is constant. So those both are constant. So what's the only variable? U. So what I'll do, I'll be differentiating with respect to U and equate it to zero. Remember that if we want to find the maximum or minimum value, we need to find the derivative and equate it to zero. And the constants here I've told are V1 and phi. So I've taken this entire term, eta H, that is the efficiency, hydraulic efficiency in this bracket. Now here, 2 is constant, so I can take it out. Your V1, I told, is a constant, I can take it out. And phi also is a constant. So of all those terms I have taken out. So in my derivative, I have got U into V1 minus U. So I'll take U inside. So I'll be getting V1 U minus U square. So derivative. Now this is equal to zero. Now here again, my 2 can't be equal to 0. 1 plus cos phi definitely not, because even if phi is 90 degree and cos phi is 0, it is added to 1. And even v1 can't be 0, because if it is 0, it will become infinity. So only this term is 0. So when I find the derivative with respect to u, I'll be getting v1. If I do the derivative of v1 u1, I'll be getting v1 minus 2u is equal to 0. And if I substitute it, I'll further get u is equal to v1 by 2. So for my maximum hydraulic efficiency, my velocity of the bucket should be half of the velocity of the jet. Now I'll substitute this in my equation, efficiency equation. So this is my efficiency. So I'm substituting u as v1 by 2. So v1 minus v1 by 2, I'll be getting v1 by 2 into v1 by 2. So I'll be getting v1 square by 4. V1 square and v1 square will get cancelled. 2 is there, divide by 4. So my 2, 4, I'll be getting by 2. So only this term is remaining. So my maximum hydraulic efficiency is 1 plus cos phi divided by 2. Okay. So this is my maximum. So with this, we have calculated what is the work done, what is the hydraulic efficiency, and what is the maximum hydraulic efficiency. Now, next, coming to some design steps of Pelton wheel. Firstly, everything, your velocity is dependent on the head available. So my V1 is given by root 2 GH, I told you. I'm adding a coefficient of velocity. Your coefficient of velocity makes it your V1 as the actual velocity. V1 is equal to root 2 GH is a theoretical velocity. If I multiply the coefficient, it becomes the actual velocity. So V1 is equal to CV root 2 GH, where CV is a coefficient of velocity and the range is between 0.98 to 0.99. Then I'm having U, that is your speed of the bucket or velocity of the bucket. I'm writing in terms of phi root 2 GH, where phi is a speed ratio and the value ranges from 0.43 to 0.48. The angle of deflection, if it is not given, we assume it to be 165 degree, if it is not given in the problem. And if you remember, I had told you to remember the problem, u is equal to pi d n by 60. Now here, we'll be finding mean wheel diameter or pitch diameter by reversing that formula. So instead of u is equal to pi d n by 60, I am writing d is equal to 60 u by pi n. Remember that your design is always done after a lot of analysis. And when I'm doing the design here, I'm calculating what is the value of D, what is the number of buckets, and your number of jets. These three things are what we are calculating. So my mean diameter I'll be getting, D is equal to 60 U by pi N. Your jet ratio, M, is defined by capital D by small d. Your capital D is your wheel diameter divided by your diameter of jet. Mostly it is taken as 12. And the number of jet, this jet ratio is to calculate your number of buckets. So number of buckets is given by Z, that is equal to 15. So 15 number of buckets is compulsory, plus D by D divided by 2. Your D by D is nothing but your M, so I can write it as M by 2 also. And the last thing is the number of jet. Your number of jet is a total discharge to the turbine and discharge to single jet. So you can have turbines where multiple jets are there, 3-4 jets are there. So your number of jets is decided by the total discharge to turbine divided by the discharge to single jet. So with this, I come to the end of my design. The next class, we'll be doing problems related to Pelton wheel. Thank you.